Hello everyone, welcome on in. So in this little lecture here, we're going to be starting to go into bone anatomy and naming all the bones of the skeletal system. Now, this video here, we're going into bone structure and looking at the microscopic structure of compact bone and spongy bone. This is just a survey course, so this video isn't really necessarily needed, but I think it's important for us to then understand bone markings and then the structures and strength of bones and how they make themselves and repair themselves. So we will be adding this video here to start out this chapter as like a little introduction to it to go over bone structure. So we're going to look at the structures of long bones. We're going to describe the cells of bone tissue, and then we're going to compare and contrast compact and spongy bone. Now there are different types of bones. There are long bones, there are short bones, there are irregular bones, and sesamoid bones, and flat bones. We're not going to be going over those in this detail, but these different bones then make up either the axial or the appendicular skeletons. All right, so first here, we're going to go into long bone anatomy. So I have this long bone. So these are typically the appendages or the appendicular bones here that are the long bones. So bones that are longer than they are wide. So they have a unique anatomy to them. One, they have compact bone around the outside. So here we have layers of compact bone all down the shaft and even up around the top here. But inside the heads, so up here is the head of, so this is the femur, we have spongy bone. So there's spongy bone and there's compact bone. So two slightly different things. And we're going to talk about more of the anatomy of those later. The inside of our bones, except for where the spongy bones are, this is hollow. This is called the medullary cavity here. And within that, you can typically find yellow bone marrow. Yellow bone marrow was fat storage in our bones. Where we have spongy bone and some, so heads of the femur, hip bones, and then flat bones is where you have red marrow, and red marrow is producing red blood cells and white blood cells. So your blood cell production is happening in that red marrow, and that's typically within the spongy bone here. Now, looking at the overall anatomy, of course, there's blood vessels that come in. So you have this nutrient artery that comes in through a connective tissue layer called the periosteum. We'll go over that in the next image coming up. But then we have the ends. Well, we have the shaft. The shaft is known as the diaphysis. And the ends are known as the proximal and the distal epiphyses or epiphysis here. So the distal one is the more distal end, and the proximal one is the more proximal one, or closer to the origin. Then there's the metaphysis here, which is just kind of referring to the area between the epiphysis, each epiphysis, and the diaphysis. Some textbooks don't even use that terminology here. And then at the very ends, there's the articular cartilage, that's hyaline cartilage that forms the joint. So whenever you hear the word articulation, think forming a joint. So here the femur articulates with the shoulder, and also the the femur with the shoulder. The femur with the hip bone, and then also the tibia at the distal end right here. I was thinking of the humerus for some reason. But here, no, this is the femur here. And then some other parts here are how long bones grow. So we have, if you remember, you know, you have your growth plate. Technically speaking, that's known as the epiphyseal plate. And then as you get older, that calcifies or ossifies and becomes what's known as the epiphyseal line. And so that you're no longer growing in lengthwise. Now, we're not going to be going over how long bones grow in this survey course. That would be more detail for a full-on anatomy and physiology course. So that's the overall anatomy of the long bone. So understanding the ends, and then also how the compact bone and spongy bone are laid out in it. And because the bone is hollow here, think about when you're pushing pressure down on the femur. Let's erase some of these lines here. When you're putting a force down, you're compressing this side, and then you're stretching this side. And there's a point in the middle where there's these forces cancel out. So here's a point of compression, and here's a point of tension. And so in the middle, those forces cancel out. So the middle of these bones can be hollow for that reason. This spongy bone here as well, it doesn't show it really well in this image, but this actually forms little kind of like trusses, and they arrange themselves in certain fashions, almost like they're suspension lines for a suspension bridge. And that also give strength to the bone. Compact bone is very strong. Spongy bone isn't as strong, but it does align these along these lines of stress to help provide more support. Okay, and then all these bones have a connective tissue layering on them that's known as the periosteum, so surrounding the entire bone around the outside. So there's a fibrous layer and then a cellular layer here of the periosteum, and then this connective tissue is held on to the bone via these fibers called perforating fibers, or you might hear them referred to as Sharpies fibers, not labeled on this image. And then inside around the spongy bone and the inner lining of the compact bone medullary cavity right here, there's also a connective tissue. It's called the endosteum. So it would be lining all of the spongy bone, or here it's showing some of the spongy bone inside there. And then we start seeing some of the cells in here, osteoclasts, osteocytes, osteogenic cells, and osteoblast cells. So that's what we're going to go into next. So these bone cells that form bone tissue or support bone tissue. First up, we have what's called an osteocyte. An osteocyte, and then we can also talk about the osteoblast. Site cell is a more active, mature form of the cell, and this maintains bone tissue. You see, we have os in all of these words, and os is always the root for bone. So osteoblast is actively forming new bone matrix. Osteocytes then are maintaining that bone matrix. So you see osteoblast cells out here laying down what's known as osseous tissue or osseoid, and then that eventually becomes calcified later on, and that's what makes it hard. So this is pretty much, it's producing collagen fibers, and that's what this osseous material is, and then it becomes calcified and is bone. And then in here, in a lacuna, or the plural would be lacunae, you have osteocytes that are housed inside the bone, and they are just maintaining and then communicating with each other for anywhere that needs bone remodeling. Bone remodeling is also outside the scope of this course, but you do remodel all of your bones and deposit new bone matrix and remove bone matrix. And the cell, one of the main cells that's responsible for that, are these osteoclast cells here. Here you see it says resorbs bone. It means it demineralizes this bone matrix and gives the body calcium. So when your body needs calcium, this can activate, or if you have areas that are under as much mechanical stress and other areas of the bone that are, it'll remove bone here and deposit them in a place that has more mechanical stress. So you see these osteoclasts derived from macrophages here, multinucleated cells, very large cells demineralizing that bone matrix. And then what gives rise to these osteocytes and osteoblasts? Osteogenic cells. These are stem cells that then give rise to new osteoblasts, which eventually become new osteocytes. You might also come across the term bone lining cells, which are also helping support the bone matrix in the connective tissue layers like the endosteum and the periosteum. So those are the cells that make up the bone. And then we get into the microscopic anatomy of compact and spongy bone. So this is a really cool structure here. We talked about this a bit in the histology unit, but here we have the little osteons. The osteons are like the little tree trunks. They got the central canal, which houses an artery, vein, lymphatic tissue, and nerve. And then they have the little lamellae, or the concentric lamellae, that go around them. So these are called the concentric lamellae. Then in between the osteons, you have what's called the interstitial lamellae. I mean, here it is labeled over here, interstitial lamellae there, because you can't put a bunch of circles together. And then around the outside, you also have lamellae here. This is called the circumferential lamellae, and it would go around the whole circumference of this bone. So all these structures have collagen fibers running in perpendicular directions to each other. So they're crisscrossing as they're going. And you can see after you add all these rings and how it can make a very, very strong structure. And this is one of the reasons why bone is so strong, is because of the direction in which the collagen fibers overlap and run perpendicular to each other in each of these rings. And you put all these rings together and then you calcify them, makes it very strong. Now, if you look on the outside here, it's showing the periosteum, so the fibrous layer and then the osteogenic layer or the cellular layer, and then you need to get blood coming in. So the blood comes in, we had the perforating fibers, which are holding the layers on here, and then here is the perforating canal. So this is how nutrients get into the bone and go up and down those central canals. And then they can perforate all the way through to the different central canals and get nutrients inside the bone. So bone is pretty highly vascularized, and that's important for the repair process. And then inside here, depending on where you are, you then have the medullary cavity, which could then be spongy bone. Now, if we're looking at the smaller, you know, osteocytes housed in these little lacunae in here, they have these little channels that come out and communicate. These little channels are called the canal liculi, not labeled on this image from what I can see, but that's how they can get communication in and out and help direct where new bone is laid down for bone resorption. So that's just a quick overview of compact bone anatomy. And here's a histology image showing the little fuzziness right here would be those canal liculi. Here's a central canal. So in there would be the artery, the vein, the nerve, and the lymphatic vessel. And then you see those lamellae going around, the concentric lamellae. Then you'd have your interstitial lamellae. And then you don't see them here, but then there'd be the circumferential lamellae going around the outside as well. All right, and then here's spongy bone anatomy. So spongy bone forms these little kind of web-like pattern, and these web-like patterns are called the trabeculi right here. So the spiny-like appearance, and each of these spines is covered with a connective tissue called the endosteum. The endo is inside, and they have the little canal liculi openings for nutrients to get in and out, and then they have the concentric rings in there too. So they still have the lamellae and the endosteum and so forth. They just line up differently and don't form the strength that compact bone forms. But spongy bone itself, it's still pretty strong, and it can also go through bone remodeling with those osteoclasts right there. So that's a big thing for a disorder known as osteoporosis. So osteoporosis can create more porosity on these trabeculi of spongy bone, particularly the head of the femur and in the hip, and that can lead to a lot more fractures, or in the lumbar vertebrae as well. Osteoporosis is a big risk factor for postmenopausal women. So that would be a big factor there from overactivation of osteoclast. So this was a quick little introduction to just anatomy of bones. Again, a little bit more than what we needed in this course, but I think it's an important part to understand the structure of bones before we get into understanding the bone markings and naming all the bones, and then also going over all the joints and things like that. So this is a little intro video to the skeletal system. Hope you enjoyed it. If you have any questions, like always, just let me know. All right, have a great rest of your day, and bye-bye.